Well, hey there, American Farmsteaders. This is Jenny with the Grahamstead Family Farm.
And Donna with Hazelbell Farm.
And we are coming to y'all from Northeast Florida as two Farmsteaders doing our best to grow our own food and share our homesteading experiences with you in hopes that you will grow a little bit of food of your own.
Yep. And today we are going through a list of the top 40 homestead skills that you should know.
Yes. Maybe.
Sort of.
Do your best.
Yeah, that you can work on. How about
right.
that?
Right. Because do we do all 40 of these?
Absolutely not.
We absolutely do not.
I think that's a really good thing to kind of state at the front of this is nobody can do it all.
No.
None of us can do it all. Even, you know, if there's four in your household and you're all pulling your weight at the doing the homestead thing and learning the skills, you can't do everything.
No, you can't do everything. But maybe you have another homesteader friend that is doing that one thing that you're not doing.
Yeah.
That y'all can trade.
Swap,
like
barter.
Yeah. One of the things on the list that stuck out to me that we just don't do, we don't reload our own ammo.
No, we don't either.
But we have a very good friend mm-hmm. who reloads ammo.
Yeah. My uncle reloads ammo and he's not a homesteader at all.
Right.
Yeah. So that's a good thing to keep in mind.
Yeah.
You can't do it all, but these are all things that to strive for. And maybe some of these things will just perk your interest in what you can do at home to level up your skills.
Yeah. Right? What are you going to learn next?
Yeah.
Yeah. So at the top of the list, and some of these are going to be like pretty obvious. Okay. Like the number one is growing food, like
right.
growing a garden. Okay. Yep. Check.
Doing it.
You know, and I think that's kind of like a given homesteading skill.
Well, that's the center to me. Like that's why we do what we do is it's all about growing food. Everything,
yeah.
every part of my day is about growing food.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Pretty much. I mean, everything that we do around here, mm-hmm. it's all centered around what's going to be on the dinner table
mm-hmm.
for the most part.
Mm-hmm. Or lunch or breakfast.
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, coming in at number two, near and dear to my heart, composting.
Which is about growing food.
Which is about growing food.
Yeah. Composting. So that's something we've been working on. And we've talked a lot about that.
Yeah.
Here more recently, recent past.
Yeah. We were talking the other day about actually doing a composting class.
Yeah, I think we should.
Which I think would be a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm. I think we should.
Yeah. So we may get that together.
Go ahead. Harvesting seeds is next.
Yeah. And harvesting seeds. See, I think the cool thing about harvesting seeds is I only got into that because I'm super lazy
mm-hmm.
and I never like want to clean out my garden. And mm-hmm. so everything like bolts and goes to seed. And that's how I actually discovered like, how do you get seeds?
Oh, those are seed pods.
Those are seed pods. I'm so glad that I ignored my garden long
yeah.
enough for that to happen, you know, because before that I would just rip everything out and clean everything out. Well, you're missing a valuable resource there.
Right.
So just be lazy. Let it go.
Yeah. I had a, this was after I was vegetable gardening for many years, but I was at, of course, Ace, one of my local Ace. And, I was buying flowers. I can't remember what, maybe it was marigolds
mm-hmm.
and I'm not a flower gardener. I'm still not a flower gardener. I love flowers. I appreciate flowers. And to those of you who do it like on big scale, kudos. I love it.
I know.
I love it, but I don't do that. And so yeah, I was buying some flowers and the nursery man said, "Hey, you don't have to buy these next year. Watch this." And he showed me how to save seeds off of plants right there as he was deadheading them. And I was like, "Oh, cool." Well, that kind of gave me a kick in the pants to start paying attention to the flowers at the end of their season to look for the seeds. And so now I have a pretty decent seed collection in my flowers, a flower seed collection. Yeah.
Yeah.
That I've saved.
Yeah.
So
that's awesome.
It is awesome.
Yeah. Just be sure, you know, to pay attention to what you're growing too. Like, are you growing a hybrid? Are you growing an heirloom?
Right, right.
You want to aim for those heirloom seeds to be saving.
Mm-hmm.
Not that the hybrids won't give you something. They're just not
Maybe.
Going to be, right. It's just not going to be predictable. It will grow a plant,
mm-hmm.
but will it fruit?
Maybe.
Who knows?
Yeah. Because a lot of your hybrids are actually sterile. Like the seeds will be sterile. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My neighbor saved a bunch of, I think it was, I think it was cantaloupe seeds that they got from a cantaloupe from the grocery store.
Yeah.
And they planted them and it was beautiful. I mean, it was a huge patch. The vines were gorgeous.
Yeah.
Not one cantaloupe.
I did the same with cucumbers this year and I realized they were saved seeds that I used. And I had lots of vines, lots of flowers. I hand pollinated the flowers and I still got nothing out of those seeds. So yeah, same kind of thing. And I just had forgotten. It's another skill to add when you're doing your gardening or anything is to take notes.
Yeah.
And so that way I was able to go back and look and go, oh, those were saved seeds from, I would mark on my seed packet or Ziploc bag.
Right.
Saved from grocery store cucumber.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so there you go.
Yeah, I ran across a pack of pepper seeds that I saved, and I wrote on the envelope, have no idea, hybrid heirloom with a question mark.
There you go.
So number five is canning through preserving.
Mm-hmm. Canning through preserving.
I don't know why they wrote it out like that.
Yeah.
But anyways, preserving through canning.
Yeah. I think that's better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, so, you know, if you're not canning already, you don't have to have your own garden to do that. Mm-hmm. You can buy
produce
yep. from the actual store mm-hmm. and learn how to can it. Maybe start off with something like water bath canning, something that's going to be relatively simple. You probably already have a large stock pot that you could use. Mm-hmm. And then, you know. Once you get that under your belt, then you can go out and buy the fancy pressure canner.
Yeah, I like the Ball Blue Book. I cannot talk today. I like the the Ball Blue Book for canning, like their big book, and because it just has so many great ideas. Normally, we just can like ingredients instead of recipes.
Yeah,
but there's some great recipe ideas in there every now and then. I'll pull that out just for some inspo.
Yeah.
And it works.
Yeah. The next one goes right along with that, storing food.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So what are some other ways we can store food other than canning?
We buy our staple ingredients in bulk, our dry things, like oats, grits, flour, wheat berries, salt, sugar, a lot of those things that I'm not growing and have those stored. And you have to learn how to do that so that they don't go rancid or you don't get bugs or, you know, mold or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, learn how to do some bulk long-term food storage.
Yes. My new thing for that this past year was learning how to water glass eggs.
Mm-hmm.
So I've got several of those put up and it might actually work out pretty good because now my chickens are starting to taper off just a little bit.
Mine are just starting to molt.
Yep. Mm-hmm. I have one chicken out there that looks so ridiculous right now. Like, I swear she has two feathers on her whole self. She looks terrible.
I had somebody pick up milk yesterday who was new to our farm, and they're also new to chickens. So they just now have, like, their first flock, and they haven't experienced a molt yet.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, of course, mine are like running around like wild little banshees. And she's like, what's wrong with that chicken? I'm sure she thought like, you don't know how to take care of your chickens or something.
Right.
Like, she's molting.
Yeah. Well, and I'm kind of curious, like, is something like picking her feathers off along with her being in molt because it's that severe.
She's like, that naked.
She's naked. I'll have to get a picture of her.
That's funny.
So let's see here. What's next? Oh, using natural remedies.
Yeah. Yeah. What are some things you've used for natural remedies?
Well, and it's almost that time of year. Goldenrod season is almost here.
Mm-hmm. Good for allergies.
I picked a bunch of that last year and dried it.
Mm-hmm.
It's really good for respiratory stuff also.
Right.
One of my boys always gets bad respiratory stuff. And last year we were making a tea out of that for him that was working really well. So we saved some dry for tea.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have Biden's alba that grows like insane.
It's weeds.
It's a weed. Yeah.
and but a very useful weed. So that's good for anything hot, anything that's going to give you a fever or an infection, or like a nasty bug bite that's hot.
Yeah.
Biden's Alba is really good for all that. So we dried some of that as well, and elderberry.
And you did nettles too.
I did nettles last year. Yep. I haven't really used the nettles for anything at all yet, really. I just have a big jar of it sitting in my cabinet. But I read somewhere that nettles is like the go-to if you don't know what to use.
It's the cure-all.
It's, yeah, throw nettles at it.
Nettles is good for allergies. I do know that. I've researched that pretty extensively. And you can use it as a tea. Once and people are afraid of that stinging nettle. Yeah. But you don't have to be. Once it's dried and then steeped, it's neutralized. Mm-hmm. And so, but yeah, it works well for allergies. We started doing that at our house. So I have nettle in the pantry.
Yeah. This year when my nettles come back, I want to make a tincture with it.
Yeah, that would be great.
Yeah. Because I did make a big tincture last year, and it is a combination of all of the things that I have. So elderberry, Biden's Alba, and goldenrod. Mm-hmm. And I made like a whole quart-sized jar of it, and we've actually used half of it.
Yeah. Well, I think we could do a whole podcast on natural remedies, Jenny.
We probably could.
We should.
We should.
We'll write that
note
down.
To self.
Okay,
moving on.
So along with that comes
first aid
and CPR. Yeah. I probably need a good CPR refresher. It's been many years. Yeah.
Yeah. I haven't done any CPR classes since I was like, I don't know. I think I did one when I was like 19.
Right.
It's been a long time.
Yeah.
It's been a long time.
And my understanding is like, it's different now. You know?
Oh.
Yeah. It's different now. Like you don't do mouth to mouth now.
Okay.
So, first aid, basic first aid. I could probably brush up on a lot of those skills also, especially like with animals, not necessarily with people. But, you know, I don't want to call the vet to do a couple of stitches, but there are some times when a couple of stitches means everything to an animal. Like a friend had a goat who she caught her eye on like a carabiner clip somehow, like because of goats,
right?
Like, that's what they do,
right?
And she basically like ripped her eyelid off. It like gross.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, and so yeah, she had to like stitch it back on because without it, the goat was probably going to lose the eye. And so just a couple of stitches meant everything.
Yeah,
for the life of that animal. So basic first aid.
And yeah.
Having those things on hand and learning those skills. Learning the skills, I think, is the hard part. But
yeah,
we can do it.
Yeah. And then on the first aid note, I do save, because sometimes I'll run my pressure canner and it won't be all the way full. So I'll just do a can of water in there to like just fill the space. And I save those up at the top of my pantry just for like wound cleaning.
Clean water.
Yeah. Like if somebody gets like a really bad gash.
Yeah. That's a good idea. I have some saline on the shelf, but I have that too. I don't know why I haven't thought about that, but I usually save it for like if the power goes out.
Yeah.
Then we can have water.
Yeah.
Next, sewing, crocheting, knitting. I mean,
you know, I have a sewing machine and I know how to run said sewing machine and I've made some curtains in my days, but it's not my favorite thing to do. I'm not one of those people that finds joy in sewing or crocheting or knitting.
I do if there's time for it, but it's not where I want to prioritize my time. And crocheting, I don't know how to knit, but I can crochet, but it hurts my hands. Like it hurts my wrist. And if I'm going to hurt my wrist, it's going to be milking cows.
Right.
You know, like there's only so much the hands can do.
Priorities.
Priorities. Yeah. Yeah. So.
Yeah. But nevertheless, a good skill to have.
It is good to have.
I think it's important to know the basics.
Like we can replace buttons. We can do basic hems. You know, we can put a seam back in a shirt, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. If we absolutely have to.
Yeah.
Or you can just cut the jeans to make them the right length.
Yeah. Yeah, you could do that.
Number 10, waste nothing.
Okay. I'll do my best.
Which goes along with number 11, which is rendering fats.
Right. That's what I was thinking. Like, I'm really good at waste nothing in the kitchen.
Yeah. Bone broth.
Right.
Stock.
Leftover soup.
Yes.
Do you do leftover soup? That's what we call it, leftover soup.
Leftover soup.
That's where, when there's a little bit of leftovers of anything.
It can be
a little bit of green beans, a little bit of corn, a little bit of pasta, a little bit of meat. It's not enough to save like for a meal.
Yeah.
Right. So it goes in a Ziploc bag in our freezer. And when the bag is full, it all goes in one pot with like a jar or a jar and a half of stock. And it's leftover soup. And we'll have it with bread. And it's different every time. So it's always good. Right. Like it might have stuffing. It's so weird. But we'll do like ground meat, shredded meat, any number of vegetables, tomatoes, beans, pastas, whatever. And then, you know, I kind of look at it and assess and go, it needs a little rice at the end or pasta at the end or something.
Nice.
Bulk it up and have it with cornbread or
a
loaf of bread. But yeah, leftover soup.
I like it. Tori and I would do that. My boys don't do soup.
Oh, the boys complain about it every time.
Yeah. My boys just drain the broth off of everything.
Really? Yes. They like the broth?
Well, no, they don't want the broth.
Oh, yeah. I see.
Just give me the bulk.
The bulk, the stuff. Yeah. Yeah. I didn't like soup until I was an adult, though.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's one of Eric and I's favorite things to have a soup like that. So
nice. A good cheap meal, too.
Yeah, yeah. So we're pretty good about that. But like rendering lard, tallow. Yeah.
Rendering lard, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I'm thinking when I make cheese, the whey goes to the chickens.
Okay.
Or you can cook down your way into ricotta for a true ricotta.
Okay.
There's all kinds of things you can do to not waste in the kitchen.
Your ricotta cheese that you gave me was really good.
It's amazing.
It was really good. Taryn sat here and ate it with me one night. Mm-hmm. It's really good.
Yeah. Yeah, it's good stuff.
So yeah, you know, waste nothing points right back to composting too.
Exactly. Yeah. Anything that was once alive can go in your compost.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if it's cooked food.
Yeah. I started a freezer bag yesterday. Mm-hmm. Yeah. For extra stuff. Like we need to bulk up the compost.
Yep.
So stockpile a bunch and then you'll have it when you're ready.
Mm-hmm.
Waste nothing.
Waste nothing.
Number 12, defending your home. Whoo.
Yeah.
Yep. I just said the other day, I was always in this mindset of like head down and work.
Right.
Like I will be outside and it's head down and working and I'm just focused on what I'm doing.
Yeah.
But then we had a crazy incident, which we basically had a man ODing on drugs in our woods.
Intrude.
It was crazy.
Yeah.
And I didn't realize that he was in my woods until I realized he was in my woods.
Until he was right in front of you.
Yeah. And that changed my mindset of no, not head down and work, head up and look around.
It's on a swivel.
Like
you
got to pay attention to what's going on around you. So.
Yeah. Defend your home. Be willing to defend your home.
I mean,
we can leave it at that.
Yeah.
I think you can figure it out.
Number 13, cooking without electricity.
Mm-hmm. This is something we've gotten good at through hurricane seasons over the past years.
Yeah. I mean, there's charcoal, there's wood fire.
Mm-hmm.
Does this include propane?
That's not electricity.
Okay.
Yeah, we use propane. We specifically kept a gas stove in our house when we moved in so that we could cook without electricity.
Yeah.
So we work on propane. We can use the stovetop. We can't use the oven because it uses like the glow bar that uses electricity
to
be able to ignite. There's no pilot light for
it. But hey, if you can use your stovetop, that's great.
I can use my stovetop, yep. Now the manufacturer tells us not to, but
of course.
We're smarter than that.
Mm-hmm.
They also tell us don't drink raw milk, but we're smarter than that.
Yeah.
So next, building a fire.
Building a fire, which goes with cooking without electricity.
Yeah, we can build some fires.
Yeah, we got that down.
Smoking meats and cheeses. We do
Y'all
that.
Do smoked cheese.
We do smoked cheese. Yeah, so you need to know how to cold smoke to do cheese.
Mm-hmm.
And things like
bacon.
Bacon, yeah. Mm-hmm. Prosciutto, if you're going to do that.
I have a plan. Yes.
I'm excited about it.
Well, and one of the things that wasn't on this list was salt curing meat, mm-hmm. but I really feel like it goes into this category with smoking meats and cheeses. It just does. So a friend of mine sent me a video the other day on salt curing a whole entire leg of lamb. Mm. And so she does. She takes this big leg of lamb and she said you could do just salt, but mm-hmm. she did salt, sugar, and some other spices. Mm-hmm. And basically you're just coating it. You're trimming it up so your surface is nice and even. You don't want any like pieces of fat hanging off or, right. you know, you want everything nice and uniform and smooth. Coat it with your mixture. She put it into a... like a Rubbermaid bin mm-hmm. that
like
she
a bus bin.
She drilled some holes in the bottom of it and then set that one in another one.
With no holes.
With no holes.
Right, okay.
And so as your cure is working, there's going to be liquid that's coming out of that. So that gives a place for the liquid to drain because you're not wanting the leg to sit in the liquid mm-hmm. while it's curing. Mm-hmm. So she was checking it like every 5 days. She would add more of the salt sugar mix if she thought it needed it. Mm-hmm. And I can't remember how many days she went for, maybe like a month and a half or
I'm
something.
I'm thinking it'd have to be a long time. We did a chicken when we were homeschooling littles and did an Egypt unit study. And
we mummified a chicken,
a whole chicken, like not a lot, not like with a head and stuff, like a whole, like you would purchase at the grocery store chicken.
That is so funny. Yeah,
but that took like 3 weeks, I think. Two or three weeks. So I'm thinking for a leg of lamb.
Yeah, it was a lengthy process. And I saved the video, but the next lamb that we butcher, we are for sure doing a leg like that. And I mean, she just cut prosciutto out of it like super, super, super thin. And she was just dying over how good it was.
Wow.
So I wish I could remember what YouTube channel it was. It was a great video.
That's cool. We'll have to search for that.
Yeah, I subscribed to it. Maybe we'll link it in the comments if anybody wants to check it out because it was a really great video. She was really informative. I actually watched the whole video.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, okay, number 16, homemade bread.
Yeah, we can do that.
Yep.
We have linked your artisan bread before.
Artisan bread.
We'll do that too.
Yep, artisan bread in 5 minutes a day. It's what got me into bread making.
Yeah.
It's the only bread that I make. It's so easy.
It's so versatile. You can do so many different things with it.
You really can.
It is easy.
Although lately my brain has been saying, maybe you should try sourdough.
Jenny, I'm on sourdough right now.
Okay.
I'm making a starter for myself and for my mom, so I'll make you one.
Okay. Boom.
Yeah.
Check.
Yeah. But yeah, sourdough, again, it's very versatile. You can do so many different things with it. And, you know, sourdough kind of became super popular during 2020, right?
Yeah.
When everybody was stuck at home and couldn't find bread at the store. Mm-hmm. And it's a more self-sufficient way because you're not always putting in that manufactured yeast. And, you know, of course you have to have the other ingredients, but,
right.
You're not looking for yeast all the time mm-hmm. and you're using the yeast that's you're like living in, like in your environment. Right.
Right.
And, so it's a good, easy way to always have bread. Yeah.
Cool.
Cool. Very cool.
I'm excited.
Yeah. I'll bring you a starter.
Dehydrating foods.
Yeah, we do that.
Yep.
And herbs too.
Yep. Mm-hmm. We have a little dehydrator that I just bought from Walmart, but the other day I saw somebody using a solar dehydrator.
Mm.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It was pretty cool. So
I have a giant dehydrator,
and
it was a gift.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I feel like freeze drying should also go into this category.
Yes, I have a goal.
Which I don't freeze dry, but man, I would really love mm-hmm. to have a freeze dryer.
Me too. I have a goal. I have a budget.
Mm-hmm.
I had the money saved before and...
And then you bought a cow?
No. No, our property taxes were double what we thought they were going to be. So we paid our taxes.
Right.
Yeah.
Also a good homesteading skill.
Pay your bills. Yeah. Okay, next.
Distilling water,
mm-hmm.
which we already kind of talked about mm-hmm. in the whole first aid CPR category.
Yeah, I mean, distilling is a little different, though. It's I don't know when you would need distilled water unless like you're living at the ocean and all you have is salt water. But see, like that's desalination. I mean, I don't know. I don't know when you would need distilled water.
I don't know. I mean, maybe if the water's just dirty and you need clean water.
Right. Yeah, I guess. Sure. Maybe cleaning water should be a better skill.
Right.
Attaining
filtering.
Attaining clean. Filtering, boiling. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Hunting and archery.
Y'all got that down.
Yeah, that's what we do. That's what we do. Yeah. In fact, my boys are hunting in a location this year that, so we're in Florida and here it's archery season before it's gun season.
Okay.
And we're there hunting now. No, they open earlier than we open and it's gun season on day one.
Really?
Yeah. But our youngest he's really into archery.
Okay.
And so he's honed the skill and he's like, nope, I'm bow hunt first. So he's excited. Yeah. It's funny.
That's funny. That's cool.
Yeah. Our other son picks on him for it. He's like, that's dumb. If it's gun season, you should take a gun. So anyway, you guys hunt some though, right here?
Yeah, we do. We, usually get at least a deer every year. Mm-hmm. And we're usually able to get several turkeys.
Yeah.
And we could probably get more deer. It's just putting the time into it, you know.
Yeah, is it a priority?
Right.
It is for us because it is our lifestyle in our house.
Yeah.
So it is the priority for sure.
Our freezers are generally pretty full with, you know, stuff that we raise. Mm-hmm. And so part of me is like, you know, my freezer's full.
Right.
Do I really need to go out there and take a deer?
Yeah. Well, let me share something with you real quick before we move on. I figured out last year my favorite thing to do with turkey breast, because a wild turkey is not like your grocery store turkey, or even your home raised turkey. Like it's tough.
Yeah.
Right. So, with all of us hunters in the house, like we can get a lot, I don't know what the limits are. That's another thing. Like you got to have your licenses, your proper permits, know the limits and all of that. I can't remember what the limit is for turkey in the spring, but we can have a lot for our family. And we end up with all this breast meat. Like, they're big and they're tough unless you fry it. And I'm over that. Like, I don't like frying everything, you know? And so I started canning our wild turkey meat.
Oh, nice.
And it comes out so good. I raw pack it.
Nice.
Pint jars. If you're doing this, is our good food preservation thing here, right? So a pint is going to be about a pound of meat.
Okay.
And I just cut it in chunks, cut out any of the like tendons and the tough parts.
Okay.
It's pretty lean anyways. So you're not worried about fat. I don't even cover it with water or anything. I started seasoning it with like some thyme and some rosemary and salt. And, put them in the pressure canner. I don't remember the time. I want to say it's like 40 minutes, maybe 30 minutes for pints.
Yeah. Something like that,
35, 40 minutes, and shelf-stable food that we hunted from the yard or the hunting club or a friend's property, whatever, you know.
Yeah, that's what we did with our the deer that we got last year.
You canned it.
Everything but the back strap.
Yeah.
I cubed up, and I pressure canned it, and it turned out amazing.
Yeah.
It's tender, great. Just shreds.
Right, right.
But now our turkey, what I do with the turkey breast, and we primarily just eat the breast on a wild turkey. Everything else is just too tough.
Yeah.
I take a bunch of citrus, like orange, lemon, lime, all the citrus.
Yeah.
Slice those up, put the peels in with it too, with a bunch of olive oil and salt and pepper.
Oh, yum.
Let it sit like that for 24 hours and you can bake it in the oven and slice it.
Yeah, nice. Nice.
That works pretty good. It's all that citrus.
Breaks it down, marinates. That's a good thing. Eric has a friend who just told him to do something with turkey leg, wild turkey legs. And I don't remember what he said because there's not a lot of meat on a wild turkey leg.
No.
But there is something, and I can't remember what it was. I'll have to ask him.
Wonder if you could salt cure it.
Maybe. I mean, I would still think it'd be tough.
Yeah.
They're tough little buggers. All right, moving on.
Yeah. we're not going to get through this whole list of 40.
No, we're not. Why don't we take a look at the second half and like pick and choose?
Well, or we could just finish the list on another episode. It can be the series.
We could do that.
Yeah.
Okay. So we'll call this part one.
Yeah. So we're already at number 20, which is reloading ammunition.
Yeah, we don't do that.
Yeah.
But let me tell you, we go through some ammunition. So we should do that.
Yeah. Like I said, we have a very good friend who does that. And also, mm-hmm. I was driving through town the other day, and right across the street from Academy, mm-hmm. there's a business that has opened right across the street.
That's a reload business?
That's what they do.
Oh, wow.
Reload ammunition.
Okay.
So I'm like, well, isn't that interesting? On the busy road. And
that is.
Apparently, he's doing good.
Yeah, we have a family member who reloads, and he's not a homesteader. So, like, maybe he is, and he doesn't know it.
Right.
Maybe he's a yardsteader.
Right.
But he doesn't know it. Well.
So, yeah, I mean, I say that we just cover these last 20 in another episode.
A second episode, yeah. I agree. We'll do that.
So, yeah, we're going to finish up this list of the last 20 in part two of the 40 top homesteading skills.
That you must know, maybe. No, something to think about anyways.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yep. All right. Well, thanks for joining us, guys. We will talk to you next week.
Yeah. See y'all.
Bye.